Hello, everyone. This is Evan Abrams. And in this After Effects tutorial, we're going to be making a fake 3D cylinder using shape layers. Now, why would we fake 3D instead of actually making something three-dimensional? Well, there's many reasons. Could be a stylistic thing. You want this thin, monospaced line going around. Could be that your piece is just more abstract, and that's what the branding calls for. But whatever the reason I'm making this tutorial is that someone reached out over Twitter, and I was trying to explain this technique, and I was thinking, I must have a tutorial about this. And now we do, so problem solved. Let's start faking 3D with shape layers. In this tutorial, we're going to talk about how do we make a collection of shapes look like something it isn't. That's the big takeaway. And hopefully, by kind of diving into why we make certain decisions, this will help you kind of expand beyond just making this 3D cylinder into doing all sorts of things with shape layers. So the basic concept is we need to go from looking at a circle, one view of a cylinder, to looking at a rectangle, which would be the 90 degree shift of that. The points in between need to look cylindrical. This plus this needs to somehow equal cylinder. So how do we make that happen? Well, as you can imagine, we start by making some shapes. I like to make my shapes by just double-clicking on the icon up here. This will make a wonderful shape for us to play around with. I'm just going to fill it with white, and I'm just using these colors so you can kind of see what we're doing. I like to make shapes by double-clicking up here and then dialing in kind of the sizes I'm interested in. You can make shapes by just grabbing, clicking, dragging, moving the anchor point. But doing it, this double-clicking method, makes sure everything is lined up and where we expect it to be. A lot of times I get questions about, you know, why is mine not behaving like yours? A lot of the times this is the reason, because anchor points and groupings are all out of whack. And specifically in this tutorial, we're going to dive into some of the hierarchies that are inside of shape layers and what those mean. So hold on to your butts. So we've created this square, this 400 by 400 square. This is going to serve as the middle of our cylinder. This will be the sides, and when we're looking at the face, this will be collapsed down to nothing. So we're also going to need some circles. So we're going to make the ellipse tool here, double click, same thing as we did last time, twirl down to the contents into the ellipse. You can notice right away we've got contents, a group, and then a bunch of things inside that group. Each layer has a transform of the layer and a transform of that group. This will be important later. So this ellipse path, we're just going to make that, you know, 400 by 400. One thing that we need to change about this circle here is that it should always hang out on the edge of this rectangle. This should always hang out here. So even if we resize, then this end piece should always hang out over there. So I'm going to twirl open the rectangle path. We're going to have a look at the size here. And we need to affect a position of this layer. So we could change the layer's position. We could change the position in here. We could change the position here. We have three positions to choose from. You could apply this to any of them and get a similar result. I'm going to stick it here on this transform colon ellipse one, which is the transformation of the group ellipse one. So let's set up a relationship here. Let's call around and find people with common interests and trick them into having an awkward dinner with each other. No, we're just going to take a look at this position and we're going to hold down Alt and click on its stopwatch. Now we're going to type something in. I'm going to type D equals, and you could write, you know, variable D equals if you want to get real particular about it. Then I'm going to pick whip to this part of the size, only this one part, only the horizontal part. Then I hit a semicolon to end the line. And now we're going to type out, you know, what we want the end result of this to be. A couple of closed braces, and inside we are going to go D divided by 2, comma 0. You know, this is thing, comma thing, so our output needs to be thing, comma thing. And wouldn't you know it, that does it. So half of 400 is 200, and this is going to get bumped 200 pixels over, and that's where it's going to live. So if I go ahead and start messing with this, whoa! So let's rename this top. Let's duplicate it and rename this bottom. And the bottom, of course, should live under the middle. And we need to go in here into the contents. I'm just going to hit E twice to call up its little expression here. And I'm going to change this 2 to a negative 2, which will send it over there. Let me just double check what's going on. Oh yeah, when I change the size of this, those two circles are moving along. We've rigged up this cylinder. Good for us. We need to make these things squish themselves. So the top and the bottom. It's going to hit UU and call up their things and collapse the middle so we don't have to look at that. I think their sizes should be linked to each other. So I'm going to just link the path size of this to the path size of that. But the big thing we're interested in doing is affecting their transform. So we've got transform position doing something. Let's talk about your transform colon ellipse one scale. So I'm going to call up that for either of them. There we go. And I'm going to link the bottom scale to the top because they should always be the same. These two should always be linked together, at least in this example. So now we can do like this. And we've encountered our first little whoopsie, right? So we don't want this to be happening where the stroke is getting all pinched in here. That's not what we want at all. What we need is for the stroke to maintain its full 10-point thickness all the way around. So what I'm going to do is just grab both of these and pull them outside of the group and then stack it so the group is on top so that everything up here happens first. So we've got the ellipse, we got its path, a little path information, then we're transforming that path and then we apply a stroke and a fill to it. So that's the big difference. And you can see them next to each other, right? This is after, this is before. So again, you would take these and just plomp them outside, make sure it's stacked up correctly, and you end up with this result. So that's cool, but now we have another problem. This and this should be the same thing. If this is really the bottom, these should be merged together. How do we make that happen? If only there was a way to merge some paths together. What am I thinking of merging these paths? Well, we're going to do exactly what the word suggests. We're going to take this path information and move it in here. I'm just going to do that by adding a rectangle, and I'm going to push that rectangle above here and twirl into the rectangle, and I'm going to twirl into this rectangle, close down these, and I'm just going to link the size of this to the size of that middle piece. Cool. So what does that mean? Well, if I solo this bottom, which is now really bottom plus middle, because we've combined the two onto one shape layer, that this and this can now be added together by adding a merge paths. Ooh, look at this. We merged those paths. So this rectangle plus this group, and this group has an ellipse path that is being transformed, are then merged together. So now we don't really need to look at the middle here. I'll just make this orange, but I like to keep them separate just in case I need to link things to them or use them for something else. I'm fine to leave these as controllers. They don't take up a lot of resources. So let's animate this thing. Let's make this move. So what is actually going to be animated about this? Well, the size is going to be animated. This tube needs to get longer and shorter as we rotate around. And this scale, this transform colon ellipse one scale, needs to be changed. So let's just set this to be like 50%, and let's call this, I don't know, 350 maybe. I'm not sure. We're not sure about the values yet. Let's say this is going to be a middle point. And so we go ahead 10 frames, holding shift, hitting page down. And we'll say this is going to be at zero. This middle here, maybe 300, it's going to get narrower because its silhouette, its profile here, has to get narrower as it kind of closes down like this. So we can try to figure out, you know, what that actually is, what that value should be, so that this actually makes a little bit of sense that we're going like that. I think that looks okay. Maybe bigger, smaller. Tough to say. You might need to massage that. But then we can go back in the other direction and say, well, we're going to put this to 100, and we're going to put this to 0. And so it's the relationship between these keyframes that makes the cylinder feel believable. So this and this, you know, you can't really go direct between them. If you were to do that, then you would go from here to here, and that looks kind of weird, right? It's like a weird little shape morph happening. There has to be an intermediate keyframe where this gets wider, or you need to accelerate past this awkward moment so that you don't notice it. So now that we've kind of established these keyframes, we can take these at the start, ease them, take these at the end and ease them. If we ease the ones in the middle, it creates kind of a pause, right? It's like, oh, I'm going to stop here, I'm going to stop here. So instead, I hold down Command, or Control for you Windows folk, and then I click on this keyframe, turn them into linear, click on it again, turn them into auto bezier, which makes a nice little smooth action going. Ah, smooth. And there you have it. We are now spinning around on this axis. How fun is that? Now, if you want to take it a step further and spin it on another axis, you could make a new null object and then parent everything to that null. And then you're fine to rotate this around. Whee! Now it can spin on that axis. So that's two axes taken care of. But what about rolling? What if we want this to rotate on the third axis? How would we kind of make that happen? Having access to sticking things on the top here, like the face of a coin, would really sell that. And we can just cram things into this group and make that happen. So I could just go ahead and add another group inside. Ooh, adding groups, groups within groups, layers within layers. Inside this group, I don't know, let's add a rectangle. Let's say, this is just an example. You can do whatever you want. So we're going to add this rectangle in here, and we're going to go ahead and make it a little bit bigger. And then if we want this to rotate, we're going to transform that group. So let's call this, maybe this group is like the insert. That's not how you spell. We can go in here and we can start to rotate this. And look what happens. The rotation is applied to what's inside this group. And then the squishing, that scaling, happens to everything in this group. And then we've got the stroke and the fill, right? If you wanted to have this be a different color or, you know, be a totally different thing, you would have to break that outside of what's going on in here. If you wanted to, say, stick a totally different layer on the outside here, maybe a text layer, let's say. Let's stick some text out there. So I'm just going to make an E. Ooh, interesting. Go to the character here and make it a little bit smaller. All right. Going to hit Y, stick this anchor point right in the middle center of that E, and I want the E to behave like it's meant to be stuck there. Well, that means I have to mess with this thing's scale, I suppose. So what'll we do? Call open the scale of that, and we will link this to that. Ooh, look at that. It's like it belongs. Now we need to also mess with this position, but first let's parent it to the null, and we'll go into here, the transform position of this ellipse. And so we'll parent this to that. And now when we play this back, would you look at that? It's like the E belongs right there, just by parenting things to the various attributes that are actually changing. Oh, pretty nice. So if we want that E to rotate, I would recommend precomposing it. So we're going to go ahead and precompose, and let's call this, I don't know, face. And it's going to break a bunch of things. It's going to break all of the wonderful work that we did in here, because these are no longer valid things. But let's go ahead and just stick this in the middle. You can go to the position here, and we'll just rotate it a little bit. I'm just going to rotate it, you know, 45 degrees or something. Now when we go back out here, we need this to be positioned here, and we would want this to be scaling along with this here. So we would link those together and positioning itself along like so. But that'll only work if this is parented to the null, ba-bam. And so, as you can see, if we rotate things, maybe we just set a couple keyframes for this thing's rotation. Now we can enjoy that rotating, so long as we remove those keyframes. And you can see it has been squished to fit. Not too shabby, I would say. And that is pretty much how you would make this happen. Thank you so much for watching. If you've enjoyed learning about motion design, learning about After Effects, then please subscribe to this channel and make sure you turn on notifications so you're actually notified when a tutorial goes up. Pretty crazy how that works. If you have any questions about this technique, please let me know in the comments. I'll try to get you through. If you'd like to get your hands on the project file we made for this tutorial, then head on over to evanabrams.com, pick that up, link in the description, link in the cards. If there are other topics you'd like to hear me cover, then please tweet at me, leave me a comment, send me an email. I'm Evan Abrams. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you around the internet.